Good afternoon. My name is Eduardo Brondizio. I'm a professor of anthropology here at Indiana University. And today we're honored with the visit of one of the most distinguished Earth system scientists that I know, that, you know, both two colleagues, Stephanie Kane and Doug Edmonds from geology and from international studies, have co-conspired with me to be able to bring our dear friend and colleague, James Syvitski, to this talk. So a distinguished speaker deserves actually two introductions, so I'm just here to welcome you all and welcome Jai to Bloomington. It's really a pleasure that to have you here. And I want to say just a couple of words. It has been 5 years since I had the pleasure of working alongside with Jai as part of the International Geosphere Biosphere Program, which he chaired for 5 years, and is steered into the new decades of global change research under future Earth. So we are really happy that you're here and looking forward to your talk. And thank you for coming. So, Stefan.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming inside on this gorgeous day. Dr. Jai Syvitski is here today to talk about the Anthropocene, a contested idea emerging from the earth sciences that signals a potentially powerful cultural shift in the way our species understands itself. I would venture to say that the person taking the stage today knows more than anyone in the world about the challenges posed by the surface dynamics of the Earth to peoples, their governments, and to the non-human beings who share our fate. And I expect, as I have seen him present once before, he will offer this knowledge in and through a visual extravaganza that we will not soon forget. Currently at the University of Colorado Boulder, Jai holds faculty appointments in geological science, applied mathematics, atmosphere and ocean science, hydrological sciences, and geophysics, while also serving as executive director of the Community Surface Dynamics Modeling System, CSDMS, or systems for short. This international and interdisciplinary team of experts and students create open source software that predicts movements of water, sediment, and nutrients across landscapes and into oceans. Such predictive tools are crucial for 21st century global security. Jai has shared scientific knowledge, listened to the place-based conundrums of government ministers, and advocated on behalf of their new endeavors and aspirations in 77 countries. I overheard the number in the car yesterday. I think that's right. He's also won awards, of course. Royal Society of Canada, 2009 Huntsman Medal for Outstanding Achievements in Marine Science. He's a fellow of the American Geophysical Union and will accept the SEPM Francis Shepard Medal in 2016. And he's an honorary Doctor of Science in Sustainability from Newcastle University, or is about to be. I find it quite remarkable that Jai has arrived here at Indiana University Bloomington to give this talk and to connect with faculty members in three departments, as Eduardo Brondizio had just said, me from International Studies in the New School for Global and International Studies, Eduardo from Anthropology, and Doug Edmond from Geological Sciences. All of us, to each other's pleasant surprise, in some form or another, have been thinking through intersecting research and policy interests with Jai. So before giving him the stage, I would like to thank everybody, Drs. Brondizio and Dr. Edmonds especially, and their departments, my department, the Astrum Workshop, Cassell, the Center for Analysis of Social Ecological Landscapes, Jason Kelly, the director of the IUPUI Arts and Humanities Institute, who brought him as far as Indianapolis to us, Kimberly Rogers, a research associate who accompanied him at Systems, and the Maurer Law School for this nice space to have the talk. And so now, the Anthropocene, from concept to geological epoch to 21st century science and public discourse, let's welcome Dr. Jai Syvitski to the stage.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. You know, I get to go to many countries, about 20 a year, and but I take it upon myself to go to two American universities every year, and I do get to more than two, but that's my goal, to at least get to two universities, and so it's a pleasure to be here at Indiana, even if your government is a little crazy. As I throw my hair back. okay, so, you know, I do numerical modeling. I could write equations really quickly. That's what I do for a living. But that's not this talk. I don't think I have one equation in this talk. This is a history of science, and the history of science is from me. I was a witness. I played a little role, but you're going to hear more of a witness who has just happened to be present during the birth of a concept. And you'll see, I've got the stats later, so I probably will get this wrong, but this Anthropocene working group, we put a paper out, I think it was in Science, out of 14 million, I don't know, 500 research papers. We became the 25th most impactful paper in 1 week after publication. And so that's not us. That's what this concept has done in terms of either debating on one side or the other. It's very energizing. And so that's what this is about. You're going to hear from my perspective how it came about, because interestingly enough, I never thought it was much of a concept at the beginning. So that's what you're going to hear. So, without further ado, chapter one. I'm going to tell you about the origin and the great acceleration, which is a concept behind the Anthropocene. So all ideas have multiple parents. So even though you're going to hear that this idea came up around the year 2000, there's no such thing as being invented an idea. An idea has been around for 100, maybe longer years. And maybe it had different names. The Anthroposphere was one of them, and there's many others. So I'm not going to talk about that kind of history of science, which is very interesting. Naomi Oreskes is one of the folks from Harvard. She's a history of science professor. And so she and others in the Anthropocene working group study where ideas come from. And so I'm not going to talk about that. But just so you know that even though I'm going to lay claim that Paul Crutzen, a Nobel Prize winning scientist, was the voice behind the Anthropocene, it had a longer history. With Eugene Stomer, it was launched in the year 2000. Will Steffen, you're going to hear me refer to him. He may be he's the one who I would say should own this idea, even though he didn't state it first. He was present, like I, at the beginning. But he was the one to say that it's more than just a scientific concept, a concept that says that humans have been changing the way nature manifests itself on our planet's surface. He said it's a paradigm, it's a storyline, as well as a geological epoch and all of this. My contribution, because I am a physicist, geophysicist, was more on the end of, you know, thresholds, teleconnections, tipping points, things like that, and how the Earth, as Eduardo said, an Earth system scientist, with this International Geosphere Biosphere Program, we work with 77 national academies around the world. They get their governments to sponsor that organization. And with this resources, that's what we work at. We have international core projects that study the land, the ocean, the atmosphere, the land-ocean interaction, the ocean-atmosphere interaction, the land-atmosphere interaction, looking back in the past pages, looking into the future aims. So that's where we come from, in Earth system science. We're trying to study the entire Earth all at once. And the idea is that with climate change, you can't really piece this out sector by sector. You have to study the geophysical fluids around the world. So that's the background for this. So it came up in the year 2000 at an IGBP meeting in Mexico. It came out in a newsletter, IGBP newsletter. But in 2002, it was launched by a single author, Paul Crutzen, in, I think, the journal was Nature. And this you should already know. Humans are pretty powerful. And, you know, we can focus energy. We can decelerate or accelerate natural processes. We can change ecosystems. We can alter the Earth, and from climate change, you know this, climatology, chemistry, snow cover, permafrost, sea ice extent, glacier extent, ocean volume, and the hydrological cycles. That's climate change. But we also do all that other stuff, too, really big stuff. And that's part of the concept. Because if we were only doing little stuff, this would not, the concept would not have been launched. It's that it's a big change that we're doing. So I got involved right at the beginning in 2000. Paul Crutzen, he's an atmospheric chemist, and he said, boy, you know, all this information was coming to him. He was vice chair of IGBP at the time. And he says, you know, we're changing the Earth so much, we're now in a new geological epoch. He never knew what epoch was, but he stated it. And people heard it because he had a voice. He was given a voice from his achievements. So I was asked to organize IGBP science with these core projects, Bach, Pages, and the Global Water System Project, and LOEX, and to look at how water and sediment was being moved around the world. And even though it was at the beginning of 2000, I didn't fully get it myself. I was a witness, but I didn't really get that this was going to be a term to pay attention to. And this diagram that you're looking at goes from year 1000 here to the present, going from right to left. And these are orders of magnitude on the y-axis. And we were... this was some of the work we did back in 2000, 2001, 2002, where we were looking at how these river fluxes were changing over time. And over, I don't know, 50 years, climate normals, 30 years, over some period of time, you would think that there would be some sort of steady state of what a river could pump out. And we were seeing that some rivers were changing by an order of magnitude, and the question is why? You know, is this natural variability or is this something humans are doing? And of course it was humans. And that was the story that I helped organize these other experts to contribute towards. But let's get back to my hero, Paul Crutzen. I don't know if you've ever had him here. Maybe not, no. He's not too well. But this is in honor of him. He's an atmospheric chemist. And you're seeing a geophysical fluid. And you can see that, obviously, if you do something in one part of the Earth, it could impact other parts of the Earth. That's Earth system science. And the blue is interesting. I love the blue because I'm an oceanographer. And that's sea salt. And you can see the storms, the winds going over the ocean and hitting waves and the salt spray getting picked up and going up into the troposphere. And you may look at that and you might see this yellow, these Sahara Desert dust storms that are coming off of Africa or the Tibetan Plateau or wherever. That's also natural. You would see that if humans weren't around or not, if Martians were making this movie. But what you wouldn't see is all this green. Often you can look at Indonesia and you can, there are fires. We're burning forests for agriculture. And it's putting up black carbon and other aerosols. And you wouldn't see the white. The white is sulfates from industry. So this is an example of why, I mean, Paul was getting this information way back when. It's a movie, a more recent movie, but still, he was getting this kind of information as vice chair of IGBP, and that's why he was saying, oh, we're really doing something. So IGBP put out a series of books published by Springer. And Will Steffen put out his book called Global Change and the Earth System. That's this 2004 book. And each of the core projects were putting out books. They were organizing international scientists because the IGBP has 10,000 plus scientists. And so they were organizing and they put their findings out in these books. And if you don't know the organization IGBP, you might know our sister organization, IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So we with the World Climate Research Program were the two bodies to feed the science that was being reviewed and organized by IPCC. And this is an example of a series of books that we helped provide them with information for their reports. But Will, in 2004, because we're doing this chronologically, this talk, he had a light bulb go off in his head called the Great Acceleration. And even though the figure says 2015, in this book, he had curves like this. They ended in 2000, and in the 2015 paper, he extended it for 10 more years, which is kind of interesting in itself, because if you find a trend, well, is the trend continuing? Are we making changes? But what he also decided to do with colleagues in 2015 is break out where these trends are coming from. Are they coming from the OECD countries, the rich countries? Are these trends because of the BRICS? The upcoming countries, or is it coming from everyone else? And we call this the Great Acceleration because when you plot population, you see something happening around 1950. And then if you look at GDP, you look at foreign direct investment, urban population, maybe how we use the landscape through fertilizers, maybe dams, how we put up dams. Water use, paper production, who's contributing to what? So these are the forcing factors that are behind the Great Acceleration. And this is what the community of IGBP was measuring. We were measuring the greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, methane, ozone, and we were looking at the impacts of these gases in the atmosphere, such as ocean acidification. If you put a lot of carbon in the air, you know, there's a really good exchange between the ocean and the atmosphere. And one of the impacts, of course, is the oceans are becoming more acidic. I'm an oceanographer. I taught it. I don't teach it now, but I used to teach it. And I was one of the people who didn't believe this. Because part of my lecture was to say that, oh, the ocean's such a good buffer, you can't really change it. It's one of these magical properties in the whole solar system. You won't find anything as wonderful as our oceans. And anyways, yeah, we are changing the acid content of the ocean. And many other things, and we'll get into some of these. People tell me that I should be more of a Pollyanna than a doom and gloom person. But I can't help doing a little doom and gloom. This fact that Once a week, we have another million-person city put on planet Earth, and we will for the next 100 years. Once a week, another city the size of Indianapolis, then another week later, another city the size of Indianapolis. Week after week after week, month after month. This is still going on now. You could solve all of the global, the carbon atmospheric connection, solve all of that, and you still just got this huge pressure. So the Anthropocene concept is more than climate change. Climate change, we're working on. We've got the Paris Agreement, and hopefully we can solve it in time, because it's so serious. But that doesn't solve all of our problems. And you'll find out a little bit about these during this talk. No one likes to talk about the population. So one could go through how we live as a society around the world in a thousand, million different ways. I picked four. I don't know if you like them. But we produced 200 billion CDs and sold them globally since 1982. 100 billion Bic pens. Just easy for me to get the one maker because they track that. 15 billion batteries and all the problems related to that. And here's something that's so interesting. Our currency. We had to pay cash this morning for breakfast because the machine wasn't working. And look at the energy just to make coins and paper around the world. I mean, it's 6.7 million tons of carbon dioxide per year just to have money in our pockets. So that, we live in a society, we make decisions, we may not know that. Someone had to make this calculation. Someone had to say, well, what's behind this money? And then we find out, and when we find out, that's information that we can react on. We can then say, well, that's not a good idea. Maybe we should use credit cards and have plastic in our wallet. So I don't know what claims to fame that I have related to the Anthropocene, but I can say that I think I'm the first to use it in the title of a book. My book was as co-author of this 2005 book. So, anyways, that's my claim to fame. But let's get back to my studies from 2000 to 2003. We were tasked to look at how sediment gets moved around. And I just started to get so astounded myself that what we were doing to the landscape. Because unless you really have a chance to fly around the world, see the world, and then spend all the use up all the carbon just to get to the places that I've been to, you won't know that we're literally taking mountaintops down. In the U.S. alone, 500,000 abandoned mines. We're doing this to the landscape. Multiply that times 10, times 20 around the world. We terrace landscapes. At some ways, it's amazing what we do. You know, we can sort of be proud as a species. Yeah, we could take a mountain down. People who do Earth system science deal in fluxes. How much of a volume or a mass or whatever were per unit time. And so a flux could be gigatons per year. And, you know, after giving a million talks, people always ask, what's a gigaton? So I've decided to explain a gigaton as 0.4 Great Walls of China. 3,900 miles times 20 feet high times 15 feet wide is 0.4 gigatons of bricks and stones. That's the Great Wall of China. So that gives you some idea of a Great Wall. So when I say a gigaton, that's 2.5 Great Walls of China. Just sort of have that in your head as what we're doing to the Earth system. So when you look at the islands of Dubai, which we put there just for pleasure, because there's lots of land in that area, but we wanted to put them out in the middle of the ocean. There we are. That's three gigatons of sand and rock. Hong Kong airport, they had to take out, 30 meters of mud to get down to sand and pour all the sand and gravel back in. You're in 30 meters of water. They have to go up 60 meters. So we had an airport go in for 0.6 gigatons. That's just examples around the world of how we're moving sediment around. And if you did the calculations, this is true. We humans, as a species, move more sediment around than all the natural processes, rivers, glaciers, wind. Our iron ore production is 2.2 gigatons. Our coal production, don't forget, take 9 times 2.5 to give you the number of Great Walls of China. We do that every year. That's what we're taking out of the land to burn up and put into the sky. Global aggregate, sand and gravel for cement. And look at this cement production, one single country. Now, this gets you down to governance. Because one country contributes 90% of the cement production. One country. They just love cement. But it has greenhouse gas consequences, and 5% of our greenhouse gases comes from one country deciding to love cement. That's governance and their reaction to the governance and the decisions that are made. You know, this is going to lead into the next section, the next chapter, but the question was always, well, what kind of record do we have? If all of a sudden humans were eliminated from Earth, are we leaving much of a record behind, considering to the natural processes? So I gave a talk. Somebody from the Department of Energy heard the talk and says, you should do some calculations on how we do drilling. So I did. And the U.S. has drilled 2.6 million petroleum wells. And if you measured the length, because we track that, because we want to know how deep we go, it's 5 million kilometers. Canada adds another 2 million kilometers. You extrapolate that around the world, it's about 50 million kilometers. That's 370 times between here and the moon. That is the distance from here to Mars. So that's what we're poking holes all over the Earth. We're just poking holes. And it's a global signal, as you can see with the International Ocean Drilling Project. We pretty much cover the world. And if I was giving purely a sustainability talk or an environmental talk, I would be going through in the details of this, but I'm not. I'm giving you a history of science. But these are the things that lead to the footprint of humanity. Our invasive coastal species, because of the way we interact with our landscape and travel the world, we have all these invasive species. I said earlier that we are acidifying the ocean. We're taking whole forests and we're changing them into a single species because it provides us with money, in this case, rubber. We're growing crops where we shouldn't be growing crops. So we're moving water around and then we're having to fertilize this dead soil to grow crops in deserts. And of course, urbanization is everywhere. So I'm going to talk about this. And for many of you in this room, you may find this a little strange, but this is the, because this is not your field, but this is the International Quaternary Association. They study the ice ages and the periods in between the ice ages. They're called interstadials. The last interstadial that we're in is called the Holocene. And so that's what this group does. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about it and how they got involved with this effort. So GSA Today published this paper, Are We Now Living in the Anthropocene? And this was back in whenever it was, 2000, I guess, in 8. Yeah, there it is. And the two leaders of this is Colin Waters. Colin is the director of the British Geological Survey. Jan Zelizevich is a professor. And the two of them organized a meeting. I didn't attend that one. And they're bringing the geological perspective because, and get this, because this is a law center, isn't this building? Yeah. So we have many lawyers on our Anthropocene Working Group that are part of this because this has legal ramifications, whether we choose to call this new geological epoch the Anthropocene. Go figure. But that's another story. So Paul Crutzen and I and Will Steffen, those three early people that were mentioned on this early topic, were one of six speakers that were invited to attend this London meeting. And our job was to talk to an audience that was nothing but press. So it wasn't us talking to scientists. We were talking to the press. And the outcomes were a special issue of the philosophical transactions of the Royal Society. And most of the newspapers around the world picked up the story. So we had The Economist have its headline for 1 week on the Anthropocene as an example. Because everyone's really interested in whether we have such a footprint. Because if we have such a footprint, that's like, really? Maybe we should think about what we're doing to the Earth. Maybe, as this picture shows, we're turning the Earth into some sort of Borg-like planet that we're living on. And so that's worth thinking about. But a way that I like to explain the Anthropocene to non-geologists is there was a transition between the last ice age to the Holocene where the ice sheets were shrinking, tree lines were migrating, whole animal species were disappearing because maybe they weren't suiting the new climate. You know, we had all sorts of interesting things going in North America, like saber-toothed tigers and things like that. We were reorganizing, the planet was reorganizing river systems. Lakes were created as the ice sheets were retreating. So to get a new geological epoch, that's the magnitude you want to compare humanity to. Do we measure up to that? It's like a competition. You know, how strong are we? So this working group has a couple of big questions, and they are, have humans changed the Earth system such that recent and currently forming geological deposits include a distinct and preservable signature from the Holocene and earlier epochs? And, of course, if that is true, then when did it occur? A lot of people in this debate, they're not so much focusing on whether it occurred, they're focusing on when it occurred. And so you have people who say, well, it was because there was an early Anthropocene when we started to farm the land and the methane gases were being released from domesticated livestock. Others were saying, no, it's because of this Columbian exchange of Old World and New World. Other arguments say that it was the Industrial Revolution, like Paul Crutzen when he first came up with this idea. And more recently, the great acceleration that Will Steffen suggested. This was sent to me a week ago because the working group put out a paper on plastic and they were now thinking, well, maybe we should put one out on glass. And so you can go around and you can find deposits like this. But humans produce all sorts of metals. Metals that have never, they just don't occur in nature unless you do refined smelting like humans do. And so these are particular elements put together in ways that create products that will last for millions of years. We're doing it. And so there is a signal. It's whether the signal warrants a new designation. And this is not anthropology or archaeology or geology per se, because humans have been around for a long time and they have had a signal, otherwise we'd never find their deposits. We're not talking about that. That's a different field. We're talking about humans changing the way the system works. That's what we're talking about. And if that occurs, we're looking for big global signals that are sort of at the same time all over the Earth. And when you think in terms of that, then you think of radioisotopes, because those signals can be picked up around the world from Antarctica to the North Pole to all the oceans and on land. And there's a number of radioisotope signals from our bombs that produce this signal. Oh, I want to go on to my favorite now. This is what I do for a living. I study water and sediment, and I'm going to hit these three points. So I will argue that we've changed the hydrology of the world, and even so, we have this facing us. 14,000 deaths every day simply because of lack of water. 2.6 billion people remain without adequate sanitation. We have areas that are taking water out, sinking the land, subsidence, because they're taking that water out, at a rate that it cannot be replenished. 71% of all the water we do use is for agriculture. And yet we still have huge problems, which suggests that we have a lot of work to do if we want everyone to have sanitation and drinking water. And don't forget, Indianapolis every week, for the next 100 years anyways, so this is what we're facing. So our footprint, whatever it is, it's only going to get worse. So I'm going to show you two examples of how we change hydrology. I could have picked a million, but these two should do. One's a river, small river in Italy. Natural rain events, these discharge records with discharge on the y-axis and time on the x-axis in 1954-55. Small river, it would rain, you would get a discharge peak. That's how rivers behave. Rain, flow, rain, flow, rain, flow. 1966, doesn't look like that at all. We have monthly flushing. You know, I thought it was a soccer game. Everyone went to the washer during midpoint of the... But we're changing the very nature how water flows on the earth. You look at the Nile River, a much bigger river, and you can see when we put that dam in there to create Lake Nasser, the Aswan Dam, we went from all these big peak discharges to basically nothing. And the mean annual discharge also dropped because we are now consuming that water for agriculture. So it doesn't hit the ocean. And we'll come back to that. And that was all done with no thought to sediment. So, of course, 99% of the sediment, you see this dirty water come in on the bottom, clean water leaving at the top. None of that gets to the coast. So the coast is rapidly eroding. Colleague of mine, John Milliman, he produced this. He looked at and compared to discharge around the world. And all these red dots, big red dots, that's greater than 30% decrease in discharge going to the ocean. And if you don't get that river water to the ocean, big impacts on the coastal environment. Big impacts. And you could spend all day talking about these dots, but one can say, well, why are there big green dots? Well, I live in a place near Denver. We take water from one side of the mountain, put it on towards us because they got more water and we want it, and it's in our state, so we can do whatever we want. There are many places in the states that they need water too, and they want to have way more water than nature will provide, so they pump it from the ground, and we're pumping it. And so we have more water maybe flowing towards the Gulf of Mexico simply because of us engineering the system. And when you look at the dams in the United States, you can see the Europeans, as the date clicks on by, as we put more and more dams in, it gets worse. And, you know, those are dots. They have real stories behind them, each one. But I want to comment on one little aspect of this. Take that box. I'm going to show you a satellite image. So the Mississippi, Louisiana is in that box. All those, it's a special technique for filtering out signals, wavelengths. And you're only looking at water bodies. No, the land has basically disappeared. Where you see black or blue, that's water bodies. You can see the Mississippi River going down. New Orleans. So the blue is sediment, just if you wanted to know what is giving that blue signal, but that's not the point. The point is all the water bodies except for the Mississippi River, those tiny little lakes, those oxbow lakes, all that water should not be there. So we really are changing the hydrology of how our system works. Now all that water is evaporating into the sky where it never used to. So this is an example of our footprint. And people would complain that I only showed the U.S., but so here's the world. Now we're talking about large dams. These are giant dams. So it's a little different movie. You see the year ticking on by. You can see the British Empire and the Americas and Japan. And all of a sudden, in 1952, China took off. I want to go back because people here study governance. And so around 1930, start paying attention to China, which has no dams. And this is where governance come in. You can have a new political system come in. Things will happen. So governance does play a role in all this. One of the things that my group, CSDMS, does is we map the Earth's surface twice a day for flood inundation. We're part of a NASA center, and we work with the UN. And we produce these maps, these flood maps, and that are used for disaster reduction implementation and where to get aid and all of that. And we've been measuring the land surface and flooding from rivers and coastal inundation for quite some time, and it seems to be trends increasing. The amount of flooding we have on the Earth is getting more and more. From a global climate change perspective, this would make sense because as we intensify the hydrological cycle, we are putting more... We have a warmer atmosphere, and we can hold more water. As we hold more water, there will be more intense rainfall. So that's what that story is. And so a lot of climate scientists look at that and say, whoa, you know, maybe this is the missing signal. But some of us are saying, well, hold on for a sec. Maybe this is humans are creating these floods. Okay? And so we started examining... We would take a flood like this. This was a flood. This is Bangkok is here. So this is Thailand, the Chao Phraya River. And all the red is flooded water from an event. A monsoon came to this area. And people operate dams as if dams are banks. You know, it's like money in, money out, money in, money out, money in, money out. So you don't want to release money if you don't really need it. You want to hold on to it as long as possible and use it when you can maximize your profit margin. That's how a dam operates. So this was an early monsoon storm coming. The water was filled from snowmelt. The dam operator, who I met, she's a nice person, wonderful person. She was faced with one of those terrible decisions, and the decision was to release the water or worry about overtopping. You never want to overtop a dam because that's when you could basically fail the dam. So she released the water. Deaths resulted. All this land flooded. Billions of dollars were lost. So this flood was because of the very humans that were trying to maximize the profit margin, which is what we do around the world all the time. This flood up there, another study I did was on the Indus in 2010, the year before. So fascinating. You have to go into the Pakistani Supreme Court documents related to this, because every minister was suing every other minister for responsibility of this. The Indus River is such a giant Himalayan river that it brings water down. It could take a month for a flood wave to hit an area. So you have lots of warning. It's not because you have rainfall and all of a sudden your area is flooded. Lots of warning. There was a town called Sukkur that was really worried about this flood wave coming down. So they wanted to divert the water, the flood wave, into an area that would affect very few people. Well, that happened to be the property, orchards, property of a particular minister. He had his own troops. Government sent in troops. There was a standoff. That diversion did not happen. The other side of the river failed. All this water came down. 10 million people displaced. Lots and lots of deaths. You know, highways, hospitals, everything. And the whole thing became like something that someone should do a movie on, because as this town was being flooded, there was an airport that the Americans had used to bomb Afghanistan. And so a lot of people thought, well, let's wipe out the airport, which, as you can see, has big consequences. So the whole thing was just surreal. My point is that humans are involved in these floods too, and you can't just look at that signal and say it's intensification of the hydrological cycle. I'll pick another one that's a favorite of mine, sea level, if you don't mind. Okay. So sea level in the 20th century has gone up approximately 1.8 millimeters per year. It's going up about 3 millimeters per year something now. But back in the 20th century, 1.8. So we were getting signals like this. We were saying to ourselves, well, this doesn't make sense. In fact, these maps, we basically mapped the entire Earth's surface for areas below sea level. And we were looking at this data, we were thinking, oh, this can't be right. How could you have land that's below sea level? No, admittedly, we knew about the Netherlands being below sea level, you know, a quarter of the country. But we didn't think it was widespread around the world. And we're looking at these signals thinking, how is it possible that all this land is going down? So that's the story. Because on average, where humans are living, it's sinking 4 times faster than sea level is rising. So there was a time when we had rice bowls, and the rice bowls were deltas. Flat land, organic, rich, they flood, perfect for growing rice. And what I learned from Kimberly, my colleague, and others who work in Bangladesh, and it's well known that a typical farmer in one of these deltas could not send their kids to school if they just grew rice. It's not that rich a product considering the margins and size that they have. And if they grew shrimp, voila, lots of money. They could send their kids to school. So what's wrong with that? We want to have them send their kids to school, don't we? So let's eat shrimp. Problem is, we didn't realize that the entire world would go into shrimp production. If you think back 20, 30 years, you weren't having that much shrimp, but you have shrimp all over the place now. Look at Mekong, 1 million tons of shrimp per year. It's just incredible. That's what the landscape looks like in the Pearl River Delta. So we've changed them into protein bowls. Not necessarily a bad thing, but the problem is the subsistence. So this was such a surprise. We were pioneering some techniques on the Yellow Delta They're called interferometric synthetic aperture radar, and that's a technique that can measure changes millimeters per every few months. So that's a very high resolution signal. And we were getting these bullseyes all over the place, and when we looked at them on the yellow, that turned out to be fish farms. And this is a new delta. The groundwater that they pump up is salt water, and they could use that in growing fish species that need it. The fish species produce toxic feces, and they needed to replenish the water all the time. They were sinking this land at 1 meter, 3 feet, every 4 years. So from here to the ground, every 4 years, that's how fast the land is going down. The land's already at sea level, so it's going down rapidly. And that's what's happening to these deltas. We also found out in, let's say, in the Po Delta of Italy, during when they were pumping out methane, they were sinking at 60 millimeters per year. And remember, even with global warming, we're only affecting the oceans like now, 3 millimeters per year. Then we have these towns like Jakarta. They're now 4 meters below sea level, protected by seawalls. I mean, it's incredible what we're doing to the very places that grow our food. And here's satellite images taken once a year, and I've got these blue lines for you to focus on because that's where the coast was in 1984, and we're looking to the present, and you basically see a delta sinking before your eyes. This is in the U.S. Now you wonder, when we have a storm surge, that we have problems. We've got rid of the mangroves, and the land is now largely disappearing. So what are the solutions? This is a bad solution. China wants to build a great wall. They call it the Great Seawall. It's going to be 11,000 kilometers long. They're already starting. They're going to use cement and aggregate to go around the coastline and separate the ocean from the land. They'll help them reclaim. It will also provide some protection for sea level rise, but in essence, it will change the entire ecosystem, the wetlands. Not a good idea. Never mind the global warming side of this. So I'll end with this chapter because this leads to scientists saying we need help. We need help from the social sciences. We need help from the arts and humanities. We need help from anyone who would help us. Because obviously, this is a problem that's too large for scientists to deal with. We need everyone involved. So we put on IGBP was the lead to put on this Planet Under Pressure. Our figurehead was Lynn Ostrom. So she came and she really helped us launch this 5,000 person conference that was to feed information to the Rio Plus 20 conference. We wrote the policy papers and it was a really good effort. And just as an aside, Paul Crutzen and I, we wrote a paper on Eleanor's, Lynn's last paper on sustainability. So it was bioscience, yeah. So this is the beginning of the conversation that led to Future Earth. This is how it began. And now we have the Anthropocene. Journals are popping up now. We have the Anthropocene Review. We have a journal called the Anthropocene. We have Elementa, the science of the Anthropocene. We have many books that are coming out with the Anthropocene. You will see museums have opened up new displays all over the world on the Anthropocene. We opened a couple in Germany last year. Eduardo Brondizio, my colleague and friend, he joined with me to work with the Human Dimension Program. And we put out a special issue in Global Environmental Change that's looking at reconceptualization methods. We're looking how we can even think about the future. New ways to contextualize all of this. Each of these are a talk, so I'm not going to go into detail, because this is a history. We now have Anthropocene slams. We have adventures in the Anthropocene. We have love in the Anthropocene. We have welcome to the fabulous Anthropocene era. Jason Kelly up the road in IUPUI, he put out a wonderful conference with Stephanie and others around the world on rivers in the Anthropocene. This is this paper. What are the stats? Because I keep forgetting. Yeah, out of 4.7 million papers, we hit a home run simply because we were trying to put some teeth into this concept. And it might be a bandwagon. Bandwagons are okay. Paradigms are okay, you know, because they only last a certain length of time before their usefulness disappears on us. But you can see now it's into economics, religion, water. We have manifestos. We even have how you can die or live, culture, fictions, wildlife. And so we're getting really close to the end, and I'll sum it up with a movie that sort of captures this all. But think about these two things. Just and you as an individual, your role, your place, your life in this story, because it's all of us. It's not them. There's no such thing as them. Everyone talks about them. There's no them. There's just us. So just decide how you want to figure this all out. What are we going to do? And so when I went to school, I'm over 60, can't you tell? I just learned the stuff with atmospheric chemistry or oceans or hydrology. You would learn one of these boxes. You'd learn it really well. And maybe if you're adventurous, you could talk to someone else in one of these lower boxes. You never dealt with the top one. That was somebody else. I'm trying to indicate to you that there's no such thing as something else now. There's just one system. And so the world bodies behind this have joined forces to create future Earth. You have in your university Eduardo Brundizio, who's on the steering committee of future Earth, and you need to get to him. So I'd say send him emails, phone him. Get your thoughts across. And I'll leave you with two philosophers and quotes. Earth provides enough for every man's need, but not for every man's greed. And, of course, this is almost a truism. If we do not change our direction, we are likely to end up where we are headed. And here we go with our summary movie. Pushing us into a new geological epoch. The atoms, And I will leave it there. Thank you. Yes.
So Sam has a microphone.
Thank you for the incredible description, but I noticed that you didn't give a lot of specific suggestions about what to do next. And one thing that has bothered me when I've read different responses to seeing this is that one of the dominant responses seems to be, you know, the Stuart Brand quote, we're as gods, we might as well get good at it. The idea that when you look at this, you say, okay, we've impacted everything. We might as well become the managers that we already are de facto. And to me, that seems to be exactly the wrong response, but a dominant one. And I wonder what your reaction is to that.
Yeah, talk about an easy question. There are those, and I know some of them, who've written in Science and Nature that maybe we do need someone whose role is to be like a planetary ecologist. Their job is to look and see the Earth as a whole and see how we make decisions. I know that concept. And of course, that in itself is just pie in the sky dreaming. There won't ever be such a position, but I think that comes from the science fiction literature where we were terraforming planets and things like that. And we are terraforming our own planet, but we're doing it through chaos and without planning at all. So the idea is, well, if we're going to do this, should we put a little thought into it? Well, I'm not of that philosophy. I worry about geoengineering. And that's because we keep discovering things, teleconnections, linkages, thresholds, that once we cross, we can't go back, but we don't even know we've crossed them already. It will take us more years and more study to find that out. So I'm not, you know, there are things for ocean acidification. Perhaps, you know, if you add iron to the ocean, maybe that'll take out some of the carbon, and that would be one solution to keep allowing the ocean to suck out the carbon in the atmosphere, as an example, or put some reflectors high enough up to get some of the solar radiation to not penetrate so far into the Earth. Well, that sounds like geoengineering, and the problem that I see when we don't talk, geoengineering is planetary engineering, so when I look at engineering as a whole, and not to disparage engineers, because they always do what they're paid to do, they aren't paid to solve these problems, and no one really is. So when they're paid to build a structure that's fairly safe, called a dam, they're doing this, it's going to do a lot of good. They've been told it's going to do a lot of good. In fact, they're not the ones who do the environmental assessment. It's somebody else. They're just paid to build the dam. So I wouldn't blame engineers either. And when you take this dam issue as one example, there's winners and losers all along the pathway. So you can have, I have money, a World Bank. I want to put it into a country. Why not build a dam? We'll give them the money. That'll generate hydroelectric power. So that hydroelectric power will allow factories to be built. Then these factories are built. you got employment. So that's the whole idea behind one of these World Bank hoses that spray money everywhere. They're not the ones that are having to look at the consequences of what happens with that dam. Maybe that dam is stopping this seasonal flood wave that wipes out low-lying populations. So maybe that's a good thing. But then it's a bad thing that it traps sediment. But then it's a good thing that we can get power and we can irrigate the land. But then it's a bad thing because we are leaching mercury into it. And the more you think about all of these problems, you always have winners and losers, and you get dizzy just trying to figure out, well, are we really solving anything? So the question is, at some level, we have to do something that everyone hates. We have to have a new economic model because we can't just be producing more and more and more and more, because that's led to where we are today. No blame. It's us. It's our wanting this that has led to all of that. So for getting solutions, this is where I'm thinking the natural scientists that have called the alarm to some of these things, that's what they should do. They're to understand how the nature works and the role of humans in nature. I think they're doing their job. But their job has never been to solve the problem. And I think this is where we need to have the discussion. Because finally, when we're talking about climate change, we're realizing what is the cause. The greenhouse gases, you know, are, I drive a car, you drive a car. So we're the contributors. What are we going to give up for that? And how is society going to manage itself when we give that up? Maybe we would go to solar or wind, you say. I've looked at some of these numbers. That doesn't look like such a good, easy solution to all of this, but at least it's someone thinking and we're trying. It's almost like we have to just take a breath, relax a little, and start to think about how do we live as an individual? Because I think all of this comes from us. And then how do we work as a society at the smallest scale, the mid scale, the larger scale, and how do these governments interact? If that means a new political system as well as a new economic system, maybe it's worth discussing. But I think we really have to not use the, where are your solutions to have the conversation? We need to still have the conversation that gets us in the room, that gets us discussing things. And I'm sorry if today it appeared that I wasn't the Pollyanna, but I was the doom and gloom person.
Well, you can hear me, right? This was really a great lecture. You're talking about us as humans, but there's some humans that are more responsible than others in creating these consequences. And so when you say that there are 14,000 people that are like dying every day for lack of water, the goal seems to be to provide the water. But to provide the water, you've got to increase production. So is the question one of tailoring the strategies to more pressing needs? Or is the question more generally in terms of like how humanity has been going on for the past 50 or 200 years? Seems to me that some people are producing more and getting more out of that production, but there are still people that need those goods.
So I think GMO is probably the topic that goes directly to your question. In GMOs, the value of it is to feed a much larger population in the world. So that solution is helping the poor peoples of the world. And it is enriching a few people and few companies. So there's an example where you can almost have both a bunch of rich people and helping a lot of poor people. I don't know. You know, I hear just because of the positions that I'm in with the UN NGOs that I hear these stories about India is going to have a new water system. We have a scientist in our group that's working on that aspect where they're basically going to change how water enters the ocean in India. They're having all these canals they're building. That's one example. China. Here, okay, here's one. This is will get your head thinking about this. You go to almost any hotel in China, you can't get drinking water. It doesn't matter whether it's a five-star hotel or not. You can't get drinking water in the Chinese hotels because that's not their culture. You know, they boil their water. They don't have the same treatment systems that we have around the world. And they don't mind. They're surviving. They're happy. So we shouldn't be forcing on our engineering on them to get them to do that, because that will be, that could have consequences that may get them into the 21st century in terms of water, clean water distribution, but it's also going to hurt a lot of people by doing that in that country. So there, unless we have one society, we're going to have patchworks of how we solve these things. This country's going to choose this, this country's going to choose that, and we're going to have to work together in some coherent way.
Marvelous lecture. Loved every moment of it. Quick question. Something very special happened in the 50s and the acceleration you pointed out, which I was really unaware of. Is there something we can learn from that event? Is there a change in human psyche or something that took place that is something special that we could then work from or work backward from?
So now I'm out of my depth, but I have thought about it. And so I'm going to give you out of my depth thoughts because I've been looking at those curves for over a decade. And it seems to me something happened from World War II. World War II changed things. And it was almost an excitement in the human population from this leading to the space age, leading to nuclear reactors and new power. Everyone was in some sort of weird mood. They were taking vacations. They wanted to take vacations in the furthest away places. You know, people were traveling more. You know, airlines came on. We had a lot of energy flooded onto the market. Even though we were burning it and it won't last for very long, we were still, it lit us all up. It was like giving ants or bees some sort of extra kick. And so that's what's really happened. We were content to live sort of semi-isolated country by country by country by country. And when we did that, we could feed our people. We probably wouldn't have the population we have today. We have a much richer, wonderful world today because of the cultural diversification that we've had from this explosion. So again, I see both positives and negatives in that great acceleration, but I'm not, what can we learn? Well, you might, that's the point, you might learn what caused that, but I'm not sure how that, you may have nailed it, but yet that may not be the solution to turn back the clock, because I think we've never succeeded in turning back the clock, ever. Deep thought. Deep thought. You're all here. Come on, ask a question. Or I'm going to go to your Buddhist temple and sit and meditate.
You're very... One of your quotes that you said about Indianapolis being built... Oh, sorry.
About Indianapolis being built every day, was that...
Or once a week.
Once a week, my bad. But is that people, things, what are the statistics on that?
Yeah, well, just curious. Yeah, so, you know, a population projections is a bit of an art. It's a science, too, because there's a lot of data behind it. But it's a bit of an art. And our best projections and how we reproduce the money that supports that reproduction and the economies that can support it, these are pretty good projections. And by the way, they're very conservative. I wouldn't be saying publicly these numbers if it wasn't a conservative number. Likely it's going to be a lot more than that. We're putting that many more people on. But nevertheless, and maybe this gets back to your great acceleration, usually people don't think of... the footprint just being by people. It's people times something. And that something is junk, usually, technology. And then that is multiplied by something else. And so that's the compounding of the great acceleration. You need this times this times this, and you get our mess. And so perhaps, and you can't unwind that because that population feeds back on itself. So the projections are for Africa being the great human producers in the next 50 to 75 years, while even though their reproduction rates are going down because of technology. You take away that technology and their health systems and all the things that can come with the technology, and all of a sudden, they're going to have to continue to have even more people. So that's where this interweaving comes in. You look at these equations and say, shit. Alejandra.
When do you think the Anthropocene actually started? You listed four possibilities, and you never said which one you thought.
So I do think it's the great acceleration. And when I've looked at these numbers, I've tried to see whether, you know, is it an exponential curve? Is it a power curve? And it there was something, a lot of these things were sort of linear until World War II, and then it became a new linear. It just looks sort of exponential, but it's almost like two linear lines. And so I think a lot of people who are looking at this data, they're trying to say to themselves, how can we end, they may not end all the curves, but they may want to end one at a time. So they're looking at maybe they can round this one off, they can round this one off. But just like shrimp farms, we never had it 15 years ago. We just did, I mean, this is just an amazing thing. I keep focusing on shrimp. I love shrimp, but we keep, they, you know, because they're just bugs. And, you know, we're growing bugs and eating bugs in our pizza. But it's hard to do this, to have, we can, that's, I guess, I'm driving myself nuts. Just because we can do something doesn't mean we should do something. In that case, it's helping a lot of people. It's helping them. It's contributing to all of our problem, but it's helping them. The problem that a lot of these farmers face is that they won't have any land to grow shrimp if they continue 50 years into the future. So it's a short-term solution. And maybe I want to get back to your original question at the end. You know, maybe we should make decisions that are seven generations into the future. That's sort of an Indian expression, a North American Indian expression, Native American. We should think, what's good for them? Not us, not our kids, not our kids' kids, but maybe a number of generations forward. And if we have this kind of thinking, maybe we can be saying, okay, it's only good for a short time. And yeah.
Hi. So I have a question kind of getting at the point of governance that you are
alluding to.
Yeah. Or that has kind of come up a few times. So you have, on one hand, areas of the world in surplus and areas of the world that are impoverished, and you can kind of make an argument that much of the problems that have to do with, say, take water for example, is not to do with the amount of water that we have per se, but the distribution of the water amongst people, which you could tie to governance.
Yeah.
But then on the other hand, understanding kind of a question that came up before is that the governance aspect implies an understanding of the thresholds that we are able to navigate around and actually make knowledgeable, mindful decisions of. And that requires the science aspect to understand the Earth system well enough to make informed governance decisions. So I'm wondering what you think the balance is moving forward between a scientifically literate society such that we can actually make those informed decisions with policy makers and the like.
I don't know if I can answer this, but let me answer another question that I can. People have heard me say this because I'm now going around the world saying this. I think that for the last 200 years, these academic institutions that you're a part of, the way they're set up and structured, they've served a very useful purpose. And we should, you know, think back and thank them for their all the efforts and all the wisdom that they've generated. But maybe they're not the useful things that they once were. And maybe they should change. So maybe our future leaders should be trained in a very different way. Maybe we shouldn't have these. I know universities are caught up in accreditation and, you know, having to teach so many courses to get somebody to have a certain degree, but they're still on the sort of 1840 model. And we can't have this model then getting the right people together. And so you're starting, and you see this in some of the Ostrom workshop and a few others on campus around here and other universities. Maybe that's an early beginning, but maybe we should rush that, because we need to get all the gray matter in the room that can contribute to this. And if you leave it up to any one of us, whether it be a geologist, a geographer, or economist, or an anthropologist, we just bring our baggage with us. And so we're not all that creative. And so I think people have heard me say this, we should smoke more marijuana. But somehow we have to get and get out of the patterns of thinking that we have. I also think that, and this is, I don't know, I know I'm being taped, but I'm very cautious, but I am retiring in a year and a half, so I think that we live in a fantasy world. All of our decisions and our thoughts are just one big fantasy. We have this great big fantasy that our economy is a fantasy. Who we are is a fantasy. How we view problems, how we view the LGBT community. I'm getting back to my problems with Indiana. But whatever it is, it's just a fantasy. You know, it's just, we just make this crap up. And we keep making crap up all the time. And I think, you know, we need a little reality, who we are as a species, you know, get rid of the fantasy world. And, you know, we watch television. Where is that television leading us? It's leading us into more fantasy. So I don't know. I'm thinking that we really need to break patterns. We need to break patterns. We need to show compassion for one another and still have a very rich, good life without all the crap we have. So there you go.